This is an insightful discussion with Archbishop Nicholas Duncan-Williams, Lady Rosa Duncan-Williams, and Delights Divine. This discussion will prepare you for the year ahead. Sit back and enjoy.
Everyone, my name is Delight Divine. Now, I know this year has been very tough and challenging for so many, but I have good news. Jesus is alive, and we're here today, and I pray that we'll be here for many, many more years. Now, today I have the wonderful privilege of being with God's elect. You have a man of God who is a father, an archbishop, a statesman, a businessman, one who has been a father to many across the world. And we have his beautiful wife, Lady Rosa Whitaker, Duncan-Williams, who is also a mother to many. She's a former diplomat and a wife and first lady. And so let us welcome our very own Archbishop Nicholas Duncan-Williams and his wife, Lady Rosa Whitaker Duncan-Williams.
Just a few questions just to let people know, have greater insight
on these men and women of God. So Archbishop, please tell us, how is it balancing being an archbishop, a father, a businessman, and a statesman? How do you balance it? What's been tough or easy about that?
I think, like, thank you again, Delight, and it's been great having you in Ghana anyway. I want you back. Your program here was very enlightening, impactful, and you're a game changer. So, but again, coming back to your question, honestly speaking, I would say it's all by grace, because I don't know how I do what I do. Sometimes I stand and I'm amazed at myself with the things I do. Rosa, people will always say, how do you do all of this? A businessman came into my office today and he said, you know what I've really learned from you over the years? And I said, what? He said, it doesn't matter what's going on, you seem to always be calm about things. How do you do it? And I said, I don't know. I can't take credit for anything I do, and I don't have any formula. It's just an act of God's grace, that at every given time he gives me grace to do what I have to do and to be what I am and what I have to be. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. And I tell my kids, I've never been a father before. This is my first time of being a daddy. So be patient with me, work with me, because I'm learning on the job. I've never been an archbishop before. This is my first time of being an archbishop. The prophet said, my father was not a prophet. I wasn't born a prophet, but God made me a prophet. So I wasn't born an archbishop. I wasn't born a businessman, a statesman, whatever I am. It's just grace that enables me to perform the duty I perform as a dad, an archbishop, a statesman, whatever anybody says I am, it's grace.
Amen. So, as you hear, grace is the formula, the grace of God. Yeah, be specific. The grace of God. So, same question for you, Lady Wilson. How do you balance being a first lady? I know that's different. A first lady, a businesswoman, a former diplomat, you know, so many stages. What has been easier, tough for you?
Well, I think it starts with his purpose. I always say that his purpose is more important than your passion. And I truly believe that I am aligned with his purpose for my life. And because of that, he has supplied me with the grace to do what I have to do. So I would just say purpose and grace.
Purpose and grace are the two key ingredients, as you heard. So just a couple more questions. So Archbishop, what advice do you have for someone that wants to be like you?
I know you preached on Sunday about what I have, you know, is you have to pay the price in order to carry what he carries. He preached about this former Sunday, and it's kind of stayed in my mind, like, are you willing to pay the price? So if someone is looking up to you, maybe so many different branches across the world, what advice do you have for them?
I really believe God has a plan for everyone's life. And I wouldn't say be like me. I would say be what God wants you to be and what God has destined you to be. Because your mandate, like Rosa said, and God's purpose for your life may even be greater than mine. You know, so it's finding God's plan for your life. You can use me as an inspiration, but don't be me. Be who God wants you to be. It's very, very important when God said that before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you. And I've already ordained you to be a prophet over the nations. So there is a predestination and a purpose and a plan. He said, I know the thoughts I have of you, they are thoughts of good and not of evil, to give you an expected end. So there is an expected end for every one of us. And as great as anyone may be, and you desire to be like anybody, I think the key here is being what God wants you to be, discovering the reason for your being, why you are here, why God gave you life. It is said that the greatest discovery in the life of anyone is the day you discover the purpose or the reason for which life was given unto you. So I would say that the key is to seek God and get to know why you are here. What is your assignment? And I think that is the greatest thing. I'm still discovering me and my purpose and why I'm here. And I'm paying a heavy price every day to be me. And I think God is giving me grace to be, because what I do and who I am, I wear a lot of hats. And that's why when founders and visionaries leave the scene, the generations after them, when they are not well prepared, they struggle to really keep things going, because I do so many things and it comes with grace and an anointing that allows me to function the way I function. I can be doing many things at the same time, many projects at the same time, and everybody around me is falling apart, burnt out, tired, weary, and I'm strong and I'm ready, and everybody's sleeping and I'm awake and I'm dreaming and I'm driving everybody. I think it's a special grace and gift and anointing, and it's very dangerous to see that and want to be that when you haven't been called to that and when you haven't been anointed to that. It's an anointing, because sometimes I'm surprised, and I'm surprised at me, because sometimes I can be so tired and suddenly I'm renewed and everybody is tired and I'm moving and they are looking at me and say, how is he doing this? And me, myself, I look at me and I say, what's wrong with you? You're tired, you should be sleeping, you should be resting. And I'm fired up, you know. So I think that everybody can like greatness, love greatness, respect greatness, honor greatness, be attracted to greatness. But at the end of the day, discover why you are here for such a time like this. You have a duty to perform. And the key is being prepared to perform that duty. Winston Churchill said that there come a time in the life of everyone when destiny taps you on the shoulder to perform a duty for which you were born to perform. And what a tragedy will it be, and it is, when that moment comes to find you unprepared. Let us not try to be anybody. Let's rather discover who we are, why are we here, our purpose, our mission, our talents, our potential, and perform it. Everybody has something. To one was given 5 talents, to the other 2, and another 1. Everybody has something. Everybody is given something. You have something. I have something. Stop focusing on what I have. Focus on what you got and develop what you have. And what you have will bring you what you need and will take you wherever you have to go. A man's gift makes room for him.
Wow. That was power-packed. I hope you all learned that finding your purpose, I mean, God's original intended purpose for your life, that's the key. So don't seek to be someone else. Seek to be who God has called you to be. You're God's original. So we're going to ask a question to Lady Rosa. So what advice do you have for someone who is a Christian and wants to start their own business?
Before you come in, baby, there's just something that just hit me when she was talking about find your purpose. The Bible said, Jesus said, "Lo, it is written of me. I come," he said, "it is written of me in the volumes of the books. I come to do thy will, O God." So to every one of us, there is a purpose written of us in the volumes of God's books to perform his will, a duty by God's will. Everyone. So discover that book. You are in there. Bye, baby.
Well, first of all, I do not believe there has to be such thing as a secular job. I believe that God placed my assignment in the marketplace. But my assignment is in the marketplace. But it is of God. I mean, it is my purpose. It is what he has destined me to be and he destined me to do. So I think that it is better when people, like my husband said, this great man of God, when God reveals to you his purpose for you, that should trump your passion and any other thing. And if that purpose that he gives you is in the business and in the marketplace, then do that. And you don't have to necessarily subscribe to this lie that you are not doing God's will if your assignment is not narrowly in the church. And there are those who are assigned to the church. Now, my assignment, I do have a church assignment, but I also have a marketplace assignment. But I don't see them as conflicting at all.
Yeah, so as we have heard and we're learning, you know, the Bible talks about how he gave some to prayer, some to the word. So whatever God's mandate and purpose is for your life in any sphere of influence, make sure you're doing what he's called you to do. That makes the difference. So we thank God for these wonderful words. Is there any last words you want to share with the people for going into a new year, 2021? Any last words you would like to share those viewing today?
You know, 2020 has been a very interesting and a very difficult year for humanity. And it is said that it's been the worst of times and yet the best of times. It's been a season of darkness and yet a season of light, a season of despair and yet a season of hope, a season of having everything, and yet a season of having nothing. And if you look at the Hebrew calendar, which is the original or the biblical calendar, 2021 means the year of reversing the curse. And the original calendar, 2021 is 5781, which means the year of reversing the curse. And so I want to believe and pray that in the coming year, 2021, that we will experience such a reversal of any curse from our bloodline, curses from self-committed sins, curses from the errors of our backgrounds, our father's house, our mother's house, and the curses that 2020 brought to all of us, and that we will experience such a new beginning and a divine compensation and restoration of wasted years and wasted moments, and that we will fulfill the duty for which we were all given life, to be in this generation for such a time like this. May the curse be reversed.
Amen.
All I can say is amen.
Amen, amen. So to round up this session today, I'm going to read this wonderful message. So thank you for taking your time out of your busy schedule to talk to me today. I've been blessed, and I know that everyone watching this interview has been blessed also. At this time, I would like to present a token of my appreciation to you. So this is a token of my appreciation.
Let's
all the way from Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay. Oh,
overflow. Thank you.
Thank you for your support. Thank you for giving to me. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to come to Ghana and to make impact on the life of the youth and young adults and transform, just like a Christian lifestyle network, Dominion Television. Just being able to transform the life of so many youth and young adults. And this is a token of my appreciation. It says overflow, that you may be filled through all your being into the fullness of God. May you have the richest measure of divine presence and become a body wholly filled and flooded with God himself. Ephesians 3:19. And so, of course, you see your faces here. Though your voices have been heard, will it be louder and louder and louder to the glory of God more than ever before? So this is my gift to the Archbishop Nicholas Duncan-Williams and Lady Rosa Whitaker Duncan-Williams. Thank you so much, and have a blessed evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My pleasure.